But I do want to give you a very warm welcome to our service this evening. We're going to begin just with a few choruses, and we'll stay seated just as we sing these together. I'll give us a wee rest until a wee bit later on. And just a few announcements as well. There was a couple of things I forgot to announce this morning. And first is, there's a cup of tea and coffee after the service tonight, so please don't be rushing away. So we'll do this usually in the last one of the month. So that's after the service this evening, so don't rush away. And the other thing is, on Wednesday, don't forget, it's Silver Threads at 2:30 on Wednesday, and that's Joe Beggs, am I right? Yep, Joe Beggs this Wednesday at 2:30. So those are all the announcements as well, and I think that's them all, isn't it? I'm looking around for someone frantically shaking or nodding their head at me, but I think that's it. Right, we're going to sing together. First hymn, As We Are Gathered, Jesus Is Here. And as I say, just stay seated as we sing these, please. Well, this morning when Matthew was with us, he was reminding us about in Psalm 24 of the King of Glory, and showing us also how that pointed to Jesus as well too. And he is the one who is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And so our next hymn reminds us of that. All hail King Jesus, all hail Emmanuel, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. We'll sing this through twice as well, please. We're going to sing another hymn together. This one I haven't heard sung in a little while, but I know you know it well. This is Love Lifted Me. I was sinking deep in sin. So we'll sing this together, please.
Love
But I haven't heard that hymn sung in a while, but you sung it well. You really did. Let's pray together, and then we'll sing one more time, and then we'll turn to God's word again. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we want to give you thanks, Lord, that you have rescued us, that you sent your Son into this world to give of his life, to be that atonement for our sin. And Father, we can give thanks, Lord, even for that moment in which you opened our hearts, Lord, to respond even to the message of the gospel. Lord, we want to thank you that you've done that for us, Lord, for how you've moved in our life, for how you continue, Lord, to move in our lives, and how you dwell within even through your Holy Spirit, for your abiding presence in our lives. Lord, we give you thanks. Lord, we do want to give thanks even for the time that we had this morning with Matthew and Catherine. We give thanks for the word that Matthew shared with us. We do pray, Lord, that he would know of your leading and guiding in his life as he seeks the way ahead, Lord, even for him. Father, we pray for them as they prepare even to be married next year, Lord. Just help them in these preparations and even in the important decisions that they have to make. Father, may they know their help even as a couple together. And Father, as we were praying this morning, a number just not too well, also in hospital at the moment, Lord, just be near to them. And Father, may they know of the Lord's presence with them. May they know of your comfort. May they be able to get that rest that they need. And Father, may we do pray for the skills of the doctors and nurses, Lord, even as they treat them. Father, we do pray, Lord, that you would be near to them and you would even just bring them amongst our number once again. And Lord, we also pray for ourselves as we gather around your word this evening, and even as we'll gather later in a time of fellowship as well too. Lord, we want to give you thanks for that opportunity to do that. And Father, we give thanks, Lord, for the fellowship that we share in Christ Jesus. And help us as we turn to your word. Lord, prepare our hearts also to receive that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, the next hymn we're going to sing is Wonderful Grace. It gives what I don't deserve, and I've had you sitting long enough, so I'm going to get you to stand if you're able to for this next hymn together. Thank you. Tricky timing on that one, isn't it? But you sung it well. You sung it well. Let's turn to Matthew's Gospel, and we're turning to Matthew 14. We've been in Matthew's Gospel for a couple of months now, so I feel the time is coming maybe for us to take a little break as we move on to something else. So we're going to hit the pause button after tonight on Matthew's Gospel, and then, God willing, we'll come back to it again maybe a little bit later. So it has been, with the Bible week last week and other things as well, It's been a little while since we've been in Matthew's Gospel, just a few weeks, but I didn't want to leave Matthew 14 unfinished. We were halfway through it, really. So we're reading tonight from verses 22 to 36 of Matthew 14. So let me remind you what's just happened. Matthew 14, John the Baptist, the one who'd been sent to prepare the way for Jesus, he'd been killed, he'd been beheaded. And when Jesus hears this, he withdraws with his disciples. And that begins to make a bit of a pattern as well. We see a number of instances in Matthew's Gospel where Jesus also withdraws as well too. Now, you see, it was not the time for him to be arrested or killed. There was more of his earthly ministry to be accomplished. But I want us to note that it's not that he was going into hiding through fear. It's not that, because the crowds continued to follow him. And it wasn't that Jesus was avoiding the crowds. He still was healing the sick. Whenever they came to him, he still took time with the crowds and healed the sick. So it's not that he was running in fear or anything like that. But there were occasions, and we see this happening more and more here, where Jesus and his disciples sought rest, sought time also to instruct his disciples and also to pray together. And then Jesus miraculously fed the crowd with just a small boy's lunch. That's what we looked at the last time. But now we see Jesus and his disciples once more withdraw from those crowds in verse 22. Let's look at what happens next. Immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. And when evening came, he was there alone. But the boat by this time was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them, walking in the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking in the sea, they were terrified and said, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." And Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you in the water." And he said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and walked in the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him, saying to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." And when they had crossed over, they came to the land of Gennesaret. And when the men of that place recognized him, they sent around to all that region and brought to him all who were sick, and implored him that they might only touch the fringe of his garment. And as many as touched it were made well. You know, this past week during our spring Bible week, Freddie was taking us through some of those important questions in Romans chapter 8. And he was reminding us of some important gospel truths. And he began really, didn't he, with Romans 8:28, that well-known verse that for those who love God, how all things work together for good, for those called according to his purpose. But we're reminded that those all things include even the difficult times. Our God is a sovereign God, and he's in control of all things. He can use even the trials of our life to bring about even a greater good or a greater work than perhaps even initially we can know or understand. And C.S. Lewis once said, "God whispers to us in our joys. He speaks to us in our difficulties. He shouts in our pain." He whispers to us in our joys. He speaks to us in our difficulties, and he shouts in our pain. And here in this passage, God had something to say to these disciples, but he was going to use a time of great trial and testing to actually communicate that to them, to do that work. And while accompanying Jesus in his ministry, the disciples had witnessed many things by this stage. They'd seen the power of Jesus, they'd seen the compassion of Jesus, how he'd healed the sick. He'd fed a hungry crowd with just a small boy's lunch just before this. And yet neither the disciples nor the crowd truly grasped really the significance of these things of what Jesus had done. We see that the crowd, they marveled that Jesus had done this, yes. But instead of considering the implications of what this meant, they simply wanted to make him king. In John chapter 6, a parallel account, we see that they... When they saw how Jesus could provide food, they thought, "Well, here's a good choice for a king." You know, if he can do this, if he can provide food, well, sure, we'll be fed the rest of the time. This is great. And that was as far as really the crowd, some of the crowd got. But yeah, Jesus and his disciples, the disciples too, their understanding was not yet fully developed. And Jesus was going to use another instance here to really deepen their faith. And so Jesus and his disciples, they withdraw from the crowd. And Jesus sends his disciples ahead across the Sea of Galilee into a boat to go to the other side. All the while he dismisses the crowd. And this was likely about 7 or 8 o'clock at night after Jesus had done this, because verse 23 says after he had done that evening had come. So we can't be sure about the exact time, but perhaps it was about 7 or 8 at night. But what we see is there's two real scenes here. It begins really with a time of isolation. There was another reason that Jesus had wanted to be alone, as verse 23 shows us. He wanted to go up to the mountain to pray. You know, in the Gospels, there's numerous occasions when Jesus withdraws to pray like this. For example, before he begins his ministry in Galilee, he rose early in the morning to pray. And even when the crowd surrounded Jesus, and the crowds often surrounded Jesus wherever he went, but he often sought out these desolate places so that he could have that time and pray. He prays in mornings. There's instances he goes and prays even evenings, and on some occasions even through the night as well. Thinking of the time even of his greatest testing in the Garden of Gethsemane when he prays there. And for some of the prayers, we don't always have those prayers recorded for us in Scripture. We know just simply some of them that Jesus went aside to pray. We don't always know what he prays for, but for some of them we do. For example, the Garden of Gethsemane we do, or in John 17, what's known as Jesus' high priestly prayer. We see that Jesus doesn't just pray for himself, but he also prays for his disciples. He also, even in John 17, prays for those who later will become disciples as well too. The writer of Hebrews reminds us that Jesus continues actually to pray for us as well. In Hebrews 7:25, he also even prayed for his enemies on the cross as well when he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Jesus was one who prayed often. And so if the Son of God needed to pray often, then how much more do we as ordinary followers of Jesus? We need to rely on him each day. And you know, what role does prayer have in our life? Is it maybe just a few minutes in the morning, or maybe a short time before we go to bed at night? Corrie ten Boom once asked of prayer, she said, "Is prayer your steering wheel or your spare tire?" Or in other words, is prayer the thing that controls your life, or do you see it just like something that you have there if you're in trouble? How do we see prayer in our life? Is it there just for those times when we're in trouble, or do we pray on other occasions as well? Maybe say when someone asks you that question that you're thinking, "How am I going to answer that?" Do we fire one of those arrow prayers of Nehemiah's? Do we pray a quick prayer to the Lord, "Lord, help me to answer here"? Or do we even take that time and occasion just to stop and give thanks to God, even about something simple, even that we've experienced even during the day? The Apostle Paul exhorted believers to pray often, to rejoice always, pray continually, and give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. That's 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 16 to 18. How often do we talk with our Lord? You know, is it only when things are difficult? It shouldn't be like that. You know, imagine if we treated our best friends that way. Imagine if you only picked up your friend, picked up the phone to your friend whenever you needed something. You know, your friend would be thinking, "That's not much of a friend. They only talk to me whenever they want something." You know, our communication with the Lord should be often. We talk to our friends often. We talk to them when things are going well. When we're thankful, they share our joy. They share our cares as well. We talk to them when we're going through difficult times. They share our struggles. And so it should be even in our time with the Lord as well. It's good to keep regular accounts with our Heavenly Father too. And here we see is that Jesus had been in prayer for some time. But meanwhile, there was something else happening on the Sea of Galilee. a storm was beginning to rise. Here we move from a time of isolation and a time of prayer to a time of testing. The Sea of Galilee, you see, was a large body of water. It was about 13 miles long and about 8 miles wide. At its widest point, it was about 8 miles wide. So the disciples clearly had been sailing here for some time, because it says by now they were a long way from land. John, in his account of this, says they were about 3 miles out from the shore. But the winds had begun to get stronger, the waves had begun to rise, and they were going, Matthew tells us, against the wind. They were going against the wind, and the Sea of Galilee, you see, was often surrounded by mountains. Now, what that meant was, it meant it could be sudden, it could be subject to sometimes sudden changes in either temperature or even weather conditions as well. They could have set out, people could set out in the Sea of Galilee, and it could be a lovely day, and then all of a sudden, storms could arise up. Some people are saying that was just like this afternoon. It was lovely this morning when we were leaving church, and then we got home this afternoon, and then it was so a torrent of rain was coming. But, you know, the Sea of Galilee was unpredictable. People were able to set off, and then all of a sudden they could get caught in a heavy storm. And bear in mind, some of these disciples, they were experienced fishermen. Yet even they were facing difficulty because the boat was being beaten and battered by the waves. And Mark, in his account of this, he says they were straining at the oars. In other words, the sails that they had up in the boat would have been no use to them. They were going against the wind. They would have had to take those sails down and instead resort to using the oars instead. And they were straining at those oars. The weather had become so severe. And they've been rowing for some time. Verse 25 says here that was now the fourth watch of the night. Now, when was the fourth watch of the night? The Romans divided the night into four watches, from 6 o'clock in the evening to 6 a.m. in the morning. So if you're doing your maths, they're divided up into a division of 3 hours. So when you do your maths, the fourth watch was actually from 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. So if they left at sunset, or if they'd left late in the evening, they'd been out in this lake potentially even for about 9 hours or so, even they could have been out in this lake for. And they must have been struggling, when you think of it, to be only 3 miles out and they've been there for 9 hours. It must have been some struggle. I don't know if you've been on any rough boat journeys in your time. I've been on a few. I see a few smiling faces or maybe a few grimaces because they're remembering maybe a rough boat journey. But this is one certainly the disciples weren't going to forget. 9 hours stuck out in the Sea of Galilee, battling for hours. All the while, Jesus has been praying in the mountain. I wonder, were any of the disciples wondering, did Jesus care for them? Where was Jesus? Where was he? After all, wasn't he the one who had sent them out onto the sea in the first place? Wasn't he the one who knew all things? He knew the hearts of men. We know that. Yet, he sent his disciples here out in this boat. Why? You know, it was clear this time of testing was for a reason. It was for a reason the Lord had had them here in this place. He'd sent them here, and he'd allow them also to try and struggle in their own strength as well, in order to test them. You see, this reminds us that just because we're living lives of obedience to God, it doesn't mean we won't face times of trial or testing. These disciples were in obedience to God. They were in obedience to what Jesus had told them. They had set out as he had told them. And Jesus had said he would come to them. This trial was necessary for them. It was actually necessary that their faith would grow. So in answer to that question, did Jesus care? Yes, he did. He was no doubt praying for them in this hour of trial, just as he prays for us and intercedes for us today. He cared for them, and we know he cares because he comes to them in their time of trial. And here we see it moves from fear to faith. From fear to faith. You know, by this stage, the disciples must have been exhausted. I've been out in a rowing boat, but I scarcely could imagine being in a rowing boat for 9 hours, straining at the oars for 9 hours. I think, to be honest, 9 minutes in a rowing machine, and I'd be pretty much, you know, struggling, looking for a bit of rest. But here they see something that they can't believe. They see Jesus walking in the sea. In the midst of this turbulent, stormy sea, they see Jesus walking. And you know, modern skeptics and modern critics try and explain this away, or try and, you know, deny this. Some claim, you know, no, Jesus isn't maybe walking in the sea. Maybe what it is a sandbar. And what's a sandbar? It's not a place that they have on the beach where you go get your sandwiches or anything like that, or your drinks. No, a sandbar was, it's a bit of an outcrop there of sand that comes out from the shore. And, you know, from a distance, I suppose, maybe if people were in the water, you know, they would look out and they could see someone walking along a sandbar. But here's the problem. How far out were they? 3 miles. You don't get a sandbar 3 miles out across the sea. So I'm afraid that explanation doesn't really hold up, does it? Also, some try and suggest, you know, they've been struggling for 9 hours or so, you know, and maybe by this stage they're getting a bit, you know, delirious almost. They're maybe tired, they're frightened. Could they be hallucinating? Let me ask you, can 12 people have the same hallucination? That sounds a bit odd, doesn't it? You know, you maybe imagine one person, maybe if they see something, you know, maybe one person says, is that, but 12 people all having this? No. Jesus was with them. And we know that because actually Matthew tells us he would later get into the boat with them. There was no doubt Jesus was here. He was there walking in the water. And they're trying to really make sense of what they're seeing. And they think, is this a ghost? Mark tells us that initially Jesus didn't walk directly towards them, but almost seemed to be passing by. But this didn't make a difference to them how near or how far he was. To see such an amazing sight of Jesus on the water, it was frightening to them, and they cry out in fear. In the Greek and Roman culture of the time, let me explain the background of why also they might have been crying out in fear. Well, if you see something surprising, you probably would cry out in fear. But in Greek and Roman times, they thought that ghosts would announce impending doom to people. They believed when someone had an appearance like this, they thought they were announcing basically the moment of their death. And so maybe that's what these disciples thought. Maybe they thought, this is it. This is it. Look what we're seeing now. But yet, to troubled hearts, Jesus brings comfort. Look at verse 27. Notice what Jesus says to them. He speaks to them saying, take heart, or have courage. He also says, do not be afraid. And in the midst of these two encouragements is the core reason why they need not be afraid. Why they're to take heart. Because Jesus says, it's I. It is I. The Greek here literally reads, I am. It reminds us, doesn't it, of the words that God first spoke to Moses when he revealed himself out of the burning bush. Moses had said to God that if he goes to the people of Israel and they ask who sent me, what shall I say? And God says to him, I am has sent me to you. And now Jesus uses these same words, I am, to the disciples. That's what it means literally in Greek, this phrase, it is I. He's saying, I am. Take courage, don't be afraid. It's me. I am here. Here is the great I am, the one who is sovereign over all. And he's just demonstrated that sovereignty, that deity, by showing his lord over creation, by walking over the sea. Hendrickson remarks of this glorious revelation and this word of comfort. And here's what he says. He says, this word of comfort, I am, it's firmly anchored in limitless power and infinite, intensely personal love. Jesus is showing his compassion for these disciples. He cares for them. He hasn't forgotten about them. He no doubt has been praying for them in the moment of trial, and he comes to them in their time of need. And just as Jesus came to his disciples in the great storm, in the time of trouble, Jesus comes to us even in the storms of our life too. Even more so than this, he came to earth in order to rescue us from our sins. He did this in love. And just as he came to his disciples, he's also with us too. Before he ascended to heaven, and he said to his disciples, I'm with you even till the end of the age. He was going to impart his spirit to them as well. And that spirit continues to live within us. Jesus is with us in the moment of trial. He doesn't leave us. I know there's times in our life where maybe when it seems the circumstances seem to overwhelm us, we need to remind ourselves of the truth of God's word, the fact that he will never leave us or forsake us. He knows and he cares. We needn't doubt God's love because we know of that love, because it was love that sent his only son to the cross. What a vivid demonstration of that love, the love of God for us. Jesus was with his disciples in the storm, and he continues to be with us in the storms of our life. And as one disciple hears these words, though his heart is stirred, Peter says, "Lord, if it's you, command me to come to you in the water." Now, when we read that expression, "if it's you," we wonder, is this Peter wavering slightly here? Actually, no, I don't think this is Peter wavering when he says, "Lord, if it's you." The fact that Peter's willing to step out of the boat is a bold request in itself. It proves there is faith behind this request, because he believes that if Christ can walk in the water, then he believes that by his strength so can he. And he says to Jesus that he knows apart from Christ's power, he won't be able to do that. Unless the Lord upholds him, he won't be able to do that. He knows that. He believes that. And so John MacArthur remarks here, Peter sensed in Jesus' presence a wonderful safety and comfort. And that's where Peter wanted to be. He wanted to be with Jesus. He wanted to be with Jesus in that moment. He believed the Lord could uphold him. And isn't it interesting, in that moment, he almost thought it would be safer to be with Jesus than it was to be in the boat in that very moment. You know, we know that Peter was he's a far from perfect man. He was often one that was quick to speak. He often said things before, you know, really, he truly thought about what he was saying. But we have to commend Peter for his faith here, for his willingness to follow Jesus. And so Jesus invites him to come. And he begins to get out of the boat and walk in the water. Do you know, Peter's faith may seem weak and imperfect, but as we see time and time again with Jesus and his disciples, with the disciples failing, he doesn't reject weak faith. Their faith at times may be frail, but yet Jesus has compassion upon those disciples. He graciously builds upon that faith. Though the faith may be weak, though the faith may be frail, that faith is built up in Christ. And so as Peter moves towards Jesus, he sees the wind. He sees the effect of the wind and the sea. He no doubt hears the crashing and roaring of the waves, seeing the height of the waves, and how even they're smashing violently into the boat. And once he takes his eyes off Christ, he begins to sink. He focuses on the storm instead of focusing on Christ. And so he cries out this simple cry, "Lord, save me." And as one writer remarks here, though his faith was little, it wasn't lost, because he still cries out to the Lord. It's the one he cried out to whenever he was sinking, because he knew the Lord could save him. He had faith, and it may have been a faltering faith, but he had faith in the Lord. He turned him in that moment of need. And I wonder, though, how many times are we kind of like Peter? We confess Christ as our Savior. We believe he lived, died, and rose again for us. We believe the promises of his word. But yet, when that great moment of storm arises in our life, maybe our faith begins to waver. Maybe it's a sudden bereavement. Maybe it's news from the doctor about an unexpected illness, a serious illness. Like Peter, and we may feel shaken, we may feel troubled, and we may be tempted to take our eyes off the Lord. And instead, we focus on the storm. During those moments, when they come upon us, and sometimes it might be one after the other, and we focus on those things instead of lifting our eyes on the Lord. Yet we need to do as Peter did in those moments and cry out to the Lord, because he hasn't left us. He is with us in the storm. Spurgeon remarked here of this verse that actually Peter was nearer his Lord when he was sinking than when he was walking. You see, in his time of trouble, he'd been driven to Jesus and was closest to him. And often this may be the reason why the Lord allows storms to come into our life, to drive us closer to him, to maybe even sometimes remove false sources of support in our life, that we may more fully rely on him. Maybe it's financial security. Maybe it's the false security also of our own health. He maybe removes some of these from us to make us rely more on the Lord. You see, the trial was necessary in order not just that Peter's faith would grow, but also that the faith of the disciples would grow. And we see how that happens in these verses. You see the grace of the Lord, because whenever Peter cries out, the Lord graciously answers. He reaches out his hand and takes hold of him. I thought about that for a moment and I thought, isn't it interesting the way Jesus responds there? Because when you think of it, Jesus could have simply spoke a word and the storm could have stopped. But yet he doesn't. He reaches out his hand. You know, in times of trouble, the touch of a hand is a great comfort. And here the Lord wants Peter to know of his compassion. He reaches out for him. He wants him to know his love as well as experiencing his power. And so Jesus says to him, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? Why did you doubt?" The disciples had witnessed so many things. They'd seen the healing of the sick. They'd seen the demon oppressed be delivered. They'd seen feeding of 5,000 people, more than 5,000, with just a small boy's lunch. They'd even seen the calming of a storm before. Jesus had calmed the storm before this. In another instance, and Peter had just seen his Lord walk in a turbulent sea, showing he was the Lord of creation. You know, I wonder in those moments, and I'm sure for moments to come, as maybe someone at times has said something to you, and that a question maybe is, it's stuck in your mind, the thing they've said. I wonder, was Peter like that? Was Peter maybe after this thinking, why did I doubt? Think of all the Lord has done. Think of all that we've seen him do. Certainly Peter was at a low point here. He'd been struggling with the rest of the disciples for hours in the boat. They were tired. He's been scared as well by what he thinks is a ghost. And then he feels like he's drowning. But during these moments, you know, he should have fully trusted the Lord. Yet for his failings, for his little faith, his little faith though is better than none at all, isn't it? His faith may be frail, but the Lord shows compassion. And the Lord builds up his faith. And that's the work that the Lord is doing here through this time of trial, through with his disciples here. You know, I read I'm thankful that the Bible records, you know, instances like this of imperfect people like Peter. Because recently I was reading the biography of a well-known Christian preacher. But reading through it, it was clear that the writer really, you know, idolized this preacher. It was clear that he thought, you know, this person was brilliant, and it certainly was a great man, this preacher. But here was the thing, as you read through the book, it seemed like the preacher never had any struggles, never had any trials in his life. He seemed to just breeze through everything, and I'm sure it wasn't like that in the man's life, but that was the way the man had written the book about this man's life. And I think sometimes whenever we read accounts like this in Scripture, warts and all account, you know, it does, I think, encourage us. It helps us. It reminds us that God can use imperfect people, just like Peter, and he can use us too. Think of how many times even we see people like that. Abraham, for example. Abraham is a man of faith, but he too even stumbled as well. Or David, and now the life of Peter. You know, I once knew an elderly believer who's now in glory, and when I visited him, he always said Peter was one of his favourite characters in the Bible. Because he says he reminded how God could use someone who wasn't perfect, and this man had a very difficult life in the past. And he at times, you know, would let the Lord down, and he'd grow downhearted about that, and he'd wonder, you know, could the Lord ever use me? And yet he's seen in the life of Peter how he restored Peter, how he forgave Peter. And the Lord is faithful and just to forgive us for our sins And those times when we struggle, when we let the Lord down, he can forgive us. If we confess those sins to him, if we repent of them, he is a gracious God. And it's a reminder, I think, in the life of Peter that failure is not final with Christ. Peter's faith wasn't perfect, but frail faith was better than no faith at all, isn't it? Because God was going to use that, and God was going to grow that. And so, as Jesus reaches his disciples, what a transformation takes place. Because they not only go from fear to faith, they go from wonder to worship. Do you know, notice how this storm stopped. It says, as Jesus took hold of Peter, it says, why did you doubt? And then it says after, really, this that when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. Is that normally how storms stop? Do you normally have a storm that just goes like that? It doesn't. Storms don't just stop. Usually it takes a while for the winds to die down, for the seas to even calm as well. But here, Jesus, the Lord of creation, is in control. You know, Mark tells us the disciples were utterly astounded at what happened. Mark goes on to record that while they witnessed the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000, they couldn't truly understand because it says their hearts were hardened. Their hearts were still hardened. But yet this experience in the boat had softened those hardened hearts. And sometimes that's what God does during times of trial. He can soften even hardened hearts. And here we see the purpose of the trial. Because look at verse 33. They worship Jesus saying, truly you are the Son of God. Do you know that's the first time that the disciples have used that title of Jesus, the Son of God. The previous time when Jesus calmed the storm, here's what they said. What sort of man is this that even the winds and sea obey them? But now, their faith is growing. Their understanding is growing. And they begin to see that Jesus is more than just a man. He is the one who God has sent. He's more than a man. He's the Son of God. And this word worship means they bowed down before him. This experience changed them. They were changed after this encounter. You know, if you're watching this, and I wonder, do you know Jesus as your Savior? Have you ever examined Christ's claims for yourself? The evidence is plentiful. It's important, actually, you see Jesus for who he is. Because the Gospels lay out who Jesus is. They show us that he's more than just a wise teacher. He's more than a miracle worker. He's the Son of God sent from heaven to earth to pay the price for your sin and mine in order that we could be reconciled to God. He's the compassionate Savior. He's a loving Savior, and he wants you to come to know him too, to see him for who he is. He is Lord, the Son of God, and he came to redeem us from the realm of death to bring us into eternal life. What a wonderful Savior Matthew presents to us. What a wonderful Savior we meet in the Scriptures. That he is one who cares for us. That he is one who loves us. That he's one who is willing to give of his all for us. And so in these closing verses, in verse 34 to 36, as Jesus continued to minister, when his disciples come to Gennesaret, he continues to care for the needy. As people begin to recognize him and spread the word, they begin to bring those who are sick. They'd heard of what Jesus had done. Notice how they say here, they implored him that he might only touch the hem of his garment. He'd done that, a woman had been healed by doing that for Jesus, to Jesus. She had touched the hem of his garment, the woman with the issue of blood, and she was healed. Word clearly had spread. These people, their faith was imperfect, but they had heard of this happening. You know, these were people coming to Jesus in their time of need. But you know, Jesus came to meet our greatest need. And that's not deliverance from illness. It's the need of sinners to be reconciled to a holy God. Jesus has done something to rescue our sin-sick souls. God has sent his Son, Jesus, to save us. And to experience this salvation, this wonderful salvation, we need to turn from our sin to believe in Jesus and entrust ourselves into his hand as Peter did. To cry simply, Lord,
save me. To recognize that he is truly the Son of God. What a wonderful Savior is Jesus our Lord. We truly can say that the Lord is our salvation. There's salvation in no other. For there's no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. What a wonderful Savior. And if you know the Lord tonight, let us sing praise to the Lord for what he has done, even in our life as well, for how he has delivered us. And so let us stand as we sing together this hymn, "The Lord is My Salvation."
Thank you.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we want to give you thanks, Lord, that you are our salvation, that you sent your Son to open the way to you, to be the way through the giving of his life. We want to give you thanks, Lord, that you are with us in the storms of our life. Lord, that you are ever near to us. And Father, we ask that you'd help us to remember that, to remember the promises of your word, that you'll never leave us or forsake us. And Father, even to have that knowledge that the Lord continues to intercede for us. Father, may that just encourage us. May that comfort us. And Lord, maybe even speak to someone who doesn't yet know you, Lord, even through this message. To know, Lord, that there is a way back to God. For one even who has failed, Lord, for one who has turned from you. To know that there is, that we're even rejoicing in heaven when a sinner repents, Lord. We want to thank you for that. And so, Lord, we ask, Lord, even you'll bless our time together now as we meet around a cup of tea and coffee. And Father, just bless these refreshments and bless our conversation together. In Jesus' name, amen.